He talks about MMSeq 2.
Okay. Hello. Welcome to my talk. Thank you to the organizer to give me the chance to present here. I changed the title a bit. So today I'm not just going to talk about MMSeq 2, but instead of two other methods we developed. So I have to make this a bit fast. So let's start with MMSeq 2, which is a fast sequencing search method. Here, what you can see here is the, what you can see here is the logo. It's the little Marv. It was crafted by Unicorn in South Korea. So we have this problem in metagenomics. We start with a sequencer, produce gigabytes or even terabytes of read data. Then maybe we run some assembly. We end up with gigabytes of contigs. And this, we do some gene predictions, and we end up with a lot of amino acids, which we then want to try to search against huge databases like UniProt or Keck. And the problem is this, is that the costs of the computation actually outperforms the sequencing cost. And there's also the problem that a lot of these ORFs cannot be mapped to a function. So in some metagenomes, up to 50 to 90% cannot be mapped. So there's a need for fast and sensitive search tools. So what makes a tool fast? I would argue it's the prefilter. So the prefilter is the first thing that hits the data, and the prefilter has to be as selective as possible while not kicking out too much true positives, so that you can reduce your search space quite a lot. We developed a prefilter which is based on k-mirrors. Actually, this picture, if you understand the whole picture, you're able to implement this algorithm. So at the end of this talk, I hope everybody can implement this algorithm. The idea is to find two consecutive k-mirrors in a diagonal, actually two consecutive 7-mirrors. And it works the way that you start with the target sequence database and you index that. So you look at all the 7 mirrors that are in the database. You store them in a pre-computed index table. So you have a k-mirror lookup. And for each k-mirror, you then know in which sequence and at which position the k-mirror occurs. And what you do then is you process the query one by one and go over the whole query, like in the overall overlapping k-mirrors, and you produce a list of similar k-mirrors based off our blossom threshold or profile threshold. And you can then see in which sequence they occur, and then you know this k-mirror is on position 151, and this k-mirror is on position 149. Then you can check in an array, which is a diagonal array, which has the size of the target database, if your current diagonal is the same value as the previous diagonal. If this is the case, then this is a double diagonal hit, and this is something we have to look further, because it's probably significant. And we always store then the current diagonal in this previous diagonal array. And this X is actually CPU cache optimized, so it's pretty fast. After we detected this double diagonal hit, we then do an ungapped alignment. We check if the score is above a certain score threshold. If it's the case, we do a real Swiss Waterman gapped alignment. So we benchmarked our method against the commonly used sequencing tools like Diamond, MMSeq Last, RepSearch, Sword, uBLAST, and Last, and BLAST and Swipe, and even PsyBLAST. And what you can see in this benchmark on the x-axis is the sensitivity up to the first false positive. And on the y-axis, you have the speed up relative to BLAST. And you can see that none of this fast sequencing search tools actually reaches the sensitivity of BLAST. While with MMSeq, we are able to reach the sensitivity of BLAST on a sequence-sequence search level. But we can also be extremely fast, but then less sensitive. And MMSeq also supports profile searches, so you can do iterative profile searches like PsyBLAST, and it can perform it 400 times faster than PsyBLAST, but while being even more sensitive than PsyBLAST. Well, I think that MMSeq 2 is a great tool that you can use for searching proteins and protein databases. It will probably help to reduce the amount of sequences that we cannot map through functions, because we can now use profiles. And it is one of the tools where you can also apply iterative profile searches. And it was published at Nature Biotechnology last year in October, and it's freely available at MMSeq 2 at GitHub. So please check it out. So the next tool I want to talk about is LinClust, which is a linear time clustering algorithm for huge protein sets. So In clustering, you start with a sequence set, and what you want to do is you want to know which are the representative sequences of this sequence set, and you want to assign all the sequences that are similar to your sequence to your representative sequence. So, for example, here, this green sequences are the representatives, and then you assign the sequences. And if you have this, you can do a lot of things. You can define protein families, you can compute consensus sequences, or you can just reduce redundancy in your sets. And the commonly known algorithm for this at the moment is CD-HIT or UCLUST, and they work in a greedy incremental way. So here on the left side, you have a sequence set of 9 sequences, and on the right side, you have a seed sequence set. So you start with the first sequence, you compare it against your seed sequence set. Since there's nothing, it becomes the first sequence. And you have a first cluster, then you go to your second sequence, you compare it to the first sequence. If it fulfills your clustering criteria, you would add it, but in this case it did not, so it becomes another seed sequence, and so on and so on. And if you go on like this, your seed sequence set will be longer and longer and longer, and this results in some runtime, which is n times k, so it's the amount of sequences times the amount of clusters. And if you can imagine, for very big sets, this can be nearly quadratic. And we wanted to see if this is true, so we benchmarked the tools at different sequence identity thresholds. Here on the x-axis, you can see the count and sequences that got clustered. On the y-axis, you can see the runtime that each tool needed to cluster them. And you can see that every tool has some kind of quadratic curve. So we designed an algorithm that actually, instead of being quadratic, can do the same thing but in linear time. So we need actually 20 times n comparisons to do this. And the way how we did this is lintlust. So here in this plot, you can see this black dots. These black dots are sequences. And for each sequence, we extract 20 k-mers with the lowest hash value. And then we sort them, and we define then k-mer groups. So for example, this green circle here is a k-mer group. And for each k-mer group, we then select the longest sequence, and we say the longest sequence is the representative of this k-mer group. And then we compare the members of this k-mer groups to the center sequence. And this is actually the trick how it becomes linear. Because if you would do an exhaustive search, you would end up with a quadratic amount of comparison, so you have to do an all against all. But since we just define the longest sequence as the center sequence, you just end up with the comparisons with all the members. And then we define our clusters. We check the sensitivity of our clustering method, and at 90%, 70, and 50% sequence identity. And you can see that lintlust performs similarly well to the other clustering methods at 90% sequence identity. At 70% sequence identity, there's already some gap between UCLUST and lintlust in combination with MM6. And at 50%, lintlust is quite less sensitive than for example, UCLUST or also MM6.2. But what you can do is, instead of extracting just 20 k-mers per sequence, you can extract 80 k-mers per sequence. This is gives you a speed-up penalty of 1.8. But you can increase the sensitivity quite a lot. You're getting closer to what you get from UCLUST, but you will be thousands of times faster. And to apply this to some real-world examples, we created a database called MetaCLUST. For MetaCLUST, we extracted proteins from metatranscriptomes and metagenomic assemblies, and we ended up with 1.6 billion protein sequences. And we then used lintlust to cluster them down to 424 million sequences, and it took us 10 hours and on 28 cores. So I'm working constantly on this problem to bring down the time, so I wanted to bring it down to a point where I actually drink a coffee and then I can cluster them, but I think that will be tough. And the data is freely available at metacluster.mm6.com. Oops. So I think lintlust is a good algorithm that can help you to reduce redundancy in your sets, which is often needed to increase your computational time needed to analyze your data. It is the first algorithm that can cluster protein sequences in linear time. And yeah, it can be applied to very huge sets, very huge metagenomic sets. The lintlust got accepted roughly 2 weeks ago at Nature Communications, and also the source code is publicly available at MM6 too, so you can just check it out at the GitHub. So the last project I want to talk about is a project which is not yet published. It's a protein level assembler. And so here what you can see is a metagenomic assembly. It has a lot of cat pictures. Each of this puzzle, jigsaw puzzle, is actually one genome. You can see that there are a lot of similarity between them. But if you look very well, you can also see there are some dogs here, for example, or some tigers, so which are less abundant and less and harder to see in this assembly. And so this metagenomic assembly is getting very hard because of abundances or also because of similarities between them. So we wanted to create a method that can actually extract some data from this metagenomes, and we wanted to extract actually proteins instead of just genomes, because we think genomes are often too hard for diverse environments. So why do we think this works better on proteins than it works on DNA? Is here you can see an example where you have a read layout, and here is this, the read layout, the overlap on the DNA, on the protein level, and here you can see it on the DNA level. And if you look at the DNA level, it looks like way more messy. There are way more SNPs, so there's more diversity. It's harder to capture. But if you do it on the protein level, things look more easy to overlap, and you can actually create and get proteins out. So we designed an algorithm which takes all reads and translates it to all open reading frames. Then it uses the linked list algorithm to find overlaps. If we find an overlap, we extend this protein, and we do this iteratively until we reach the end of the protein on the beginning of the protein. And this is actually an approach that is completely graph-free, so we just iterate this over and over again, so we do this all against all search. We compared the precision of this method by taking some procococcus genomes and extracting some reference proteins from them, so they're from marine. And we also created some synthetic data, which we give to different assemblers, Megahit, Metaspades, and Velvet, and two protein-level assemblers plus an SFA-SPA. And then we checked the fraction of the assembled proteins, so how high is the fraction of them can be covered by the reference proteins at 90% sequence entity to 99% sequence entity. And what you can see is that plus precision is very well until like 97% sequence identity, and then it just degenerates. But this is expected, because on the protein level you kind of lose some information on which things actually to put together. So we wanted to see how sensitive plus actually is, and we ran it on some soil samples. So we ran Megahit and plus on soil samples, and we then compared the proteins that we get out. And what you can see is that we can get longer proteins out of the soil than Megahit. So the ratio is from 3 to up to factors of 10 times more. And when you cluster this protein sequences to 90 to 50% sequence entity and look then at the ratio, we still get always roughly 3 to 4 times or even 6 times more protein sequences out than Megahit. So we are thinking that PLUS might be a good way to extract protein sequences from very diverse environments where genome assemblers have a hard time to capture any kind of diversity. Also, PLUS can do cross-assembly of very huge amount of set, because it uses the linked list algorithm. And yeah, this data can be used for remote homology detection, de novo protein structure prediction, and so on. And we hope that a preprint will be out by the end of the month. And this is the end of my talk, and I want to thank Clovis and Milot, who worked with me on this project, Johannes, who is a great supervisor, Sok Chauk, who hosted me at the Seoul National University in Korea, Cedric Notre Dame for hosting me at the CRG, and Burkhard Rost being my thesis advisor. And thank you for listening. Too many algorithms.